The main pathophysiology of organ dysfunction in this poison is free radical generation. It will undergo a series of enzymatic reactions and produce superoxide free radicals, and also it alters lipid peroxidation and it further enhances the oxidative stress and injury. All this free radical production and this oxidative stress causes triggers the inflammation followed by the fibrosis. It affects almost all organs, all the systems in the body, especially the lung and the kidney. Lung is the first organ to get injured, and this is the most common cause of the death is lung injury and hypoxia. Maximum concentration will be attained in the lung because the absorption or accumulation of the poison in the lung is against concentration gradient. Other important organs: kidney, lung, liver and muscle. When it comes to lung, there are three phases. First is destructive, then proliferative, last is fibrotic phase. In the first few hours, within 24 to 48 hours, it will affect type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes, causes disruption of all these cells and alveolar epithelium, damage of mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum, causes sloughing of alveoli and pulmonary edema, can cause ARDS, hypoxia, patient may require invasive ventilation. The second phase is proliferatory phase. In this phase, alveoli will be filled with mononuclear fibroblast and will mature into fibroblast within days to weeks. The complete fibrosis may set into within 5 to 6 weeks or may take few months in some patients. The second organ to take hit is kidney. In the kidney, there will be vacuolation and necrosis of especially proximal convoluted tubule, leads to acute kidney injury. Most of the patients will land up with dialysis. Liver, there will be congestion, hepatocellular injury, and the mechanism is the same, the destruction of mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum degranulation. This will result in hepatitis, sometimes liver failure, jaundice and elevation of SGOT, SGPT are the clinical signs. What is the toxicokinetics? Immediately after consumption, rapidly absorbed into the circulation, but immediately after absorption, 90% of absorbed poison will eliminated through the kidney. But after first few hours, after 4 to 6 hours, this renal elimination will decrease drastically and most of the poison will get accumulated in all end organs, especially lung and kidney, followed by liver and muscles. Initial elimination half-life is very fast, that is 6 hours, but later on, as it has been circulated or deposited in other tissue compartments, the elimination will be almost the elimination half-life after 6 hours is around 4 days. After first day is around 4 days, because it has been, the poison has been accumulated in other tissue compartments. What are the clinical features? If patient takes smaller amounts, lung and kidney damage will happen within 2 to 3 days. Higher doses, almost all the systems of the body, along with lung and kidney, liver, cardiovascular system, and central nervous system. The major clinical features are first hypoxia and hypercarbia. Fibrosis may take up to 5 weeks. So there will be problem with the diffusion of oxygen, oxygenation and ventilation. There will be problem with diffusion capacity of alveolo-capillary membrane will come down. The major point that we have to remember here is we need to avoid starting the patient on oxygen as far as possible. Unless patient is going into distress and respiratory arrest, increasing trends of the lactate. As long as possible, we can accept even saturation of 50 or 40, but we should not keep patient on oxygen, because keeping patient on oxygen further worsens oxidative injury and accelerate the process of lung fibrosis, may leads to irreversible lung damage. Other features, it causes mucosal ulceration, especially the tongue ulcerations will be there, esophageal ulceration, gut ulceration, perforation can happen. Some patients may present with esophagitis and esophageal perforation results in mediastinitis. Most of the patients will have tongue ulcerations. CNS involvement in case of severe poisoning, there will be coma and seizures, some cerebral dysfunction will be there, acute kidney injury, jaundice, hepatitis, liver failure and shock. Bedside urine test is a semi-quantitative test. It helps for rapid detection or confirmation of paraquat poison. It's a basically semi-quantitative test. In this test, we mix the 10 ml of urine sample with 2 ml of freshly prepared 1% sodium dithionate. With in 1 N sodium hydroxide is added and mixed well. So we have to add a freshly prepared sodium dithionate with sodium hydroxide, 10 ml of urine sample with 2 ml of this reagent. If paraquat is there in the urine, it turn into blue or green color. If it is black color, that means the concentration of the poison is very high. It can detect up to 1 microgram per ml of concentration of the poison in the urine. So the basic principle is in an alkaline medium, sodium dithionate reduces paraquat to a blue radical. The reagents that here we require is the sodium bicarbonate and sodium dithionate. We need to prepare that reagent, and 2 ml of that reagent we need to add to 10 ml of urine sample. So this is normal. Blue color is positive test, and if it is black, the severity of the poison is very much high. So we will take 10 milliliters of urine in a clean plastic cup, and we will add 2 grams of sodium bicarbonate. Once this sodium bicarbonate salt completely dissolved in the urine, we will add 1 gram of sodium dithionate. So this addition of sodium dithionate should convert paraquat into blue color radical. That is the principle. So this is the clean sample without paraquat. It is positive control. If it turns into blue, that is positive. It is dark blue or dark color, that the severity of the poison is very much. We'll add 2 grams of sodium bicarbonate into the urine first, into 10 ml of urine. Once the salt is dissolved, once the urine becomes alkaline, we need to add 1 gram of sodium dithionate. So management, of course, resuscitation, airway breathing control, airway breathing circulation. We need to protect the airway, the high chances of mucosal ulceration and sometimes high likelihood to aspirate, protect the airway. And if patient presents within 1 hour of consumption, activated charcoal gastric lavage is indicated. After 1 hour, there is no role. Before going ahead with charcoal gastric lavage, please ensure that patient's airway is protected. Other main modality of the treatment is hemoperfusion or hemodialysis to remove the poison from the circulation. Ideally, if it has to be initiated within 2 hours. For the maximum benefit, after 2 to 6 hours, it may not alter overall outcome, because by that time the poison will get accumulated in the lung. So it may decrease the concentration of the plasma, it may increase the survival time, but overall outcome will not be changed as per current available data. But take a chance. If patient presents to you with paraquat poisoning, start with hemodialysis and hemoperfusion for the benefit of that even after 2 hours of the presentation. So this is called paraquat tongue. So ulceration of the tongue because of the paraquat. So this red line is lung concentration of the drug. Observe, this is normal toxicokinetics. Within 2 to 3 hours, it's reaching a peak. If we can start hemoperfusion within 2 hours, it's the lung concentration is coming down drastically. Lung and tissue concentration, majorly lung concentration. If it is, if we are starting dialysis after 2 hours, means hardly any change. This is normal toxicokinetics. It's reaching peak around 3 micrograms or 4 micrograms per ml. If we are starting dialysis after 2 hours, after 3 hours, there's no much change. Maybe 3 to 3.5 micrograms per ml. After 6 hours, almost zero change. So ideally, we need to decrease lung damage and to improve overall outcome. Ideally, we need to start hemoperfusion or dialysis within 2 hours, but never better than late. Even take a chance and start every patient on hemoperfusion or dialysis soon after presentation to you. Other modalities to alter free radical production or to suppress the immunity and to suppress inflammatory process, steroids and cyclophosphamide. These are two common modalities that being those are being used by many physicians. 1 gram methylprednisolone daily for 3 days, 1 gram of cyclophosphamide daily for 2 days, but no strong recommendation for these modalities of the treatment. Other supportive treatment, vitamin E, vitamin C and N-acetyl cysteine as to prevent oxidative damage or oxidative stress. ECMO, as of now, ECMO also doesn't have any strong evidence. Only if the patient is planned for lung transplant, to avoid prolong the survival time, we can use ECMO as a bridge to transplant therapy. And we can continue the ECMO support till patient gets organ in case of severe lung fibrosis. Otherwise, it will not improve any outcome, or it will not improve the survival.